how do we celebrate the idea that there is quite a lot of good work that is being done by people's groups, community groups, and individuals? So establish linkages with them. You bring in the curriculum and the capability, they bring in the experience and their work, and create your program of a kind whereby you create new cadre of professionals. And new cadre of professionals who would have the capability to work at the community level, work at the sub-regional level, like the taluka or district, and also would be able to work in institutional contexts. And that was the idea that working with someone like Dr. Vandana Gopikumar, I think this, he can drive you as a boss local, actually. So, you know, when you get into that kind of energy, you know, we created a program in Calicut. We worked on a program in Chennai, in Ranchi, and also in Mumbai. You know, that's our mother place. You know, we also started a program in Mumbai. The idea is that eventually the Tata Institute of Social Sciences will incubate a number of decentralized programs across the country, bring in a quality framework that those programs will be known for their quality and experiential learning of their programs, and create a strong cadre of professionals, you know, who can work at various levels. I think that's the idea. And we also bring in the research component of it. The idea is that the mental health context is context specific. You know, you can't be doing research from Mumbai. You know, you needed to get to the context, the ecosystem, and that is where this kind of decentralized institutional setup, whereby research can also be taken up. And the students are a great resource. I must tell you that, you know, what they can do, you know, we can only facilitate. So by virtue of having these decentralized programs with capability for research, field action and demonstration, and advocacy with the state and non-state organizations, that the idea is that we create a context whereby, you know, mental health field becomes far more responsive, far more reliable, institutional setup. I think that's the idea. Towards this extent, that we thought that we need to celebrate people who are contributing to that. So we have been after Dr. Vandana Gopikumar, who became a doctor first last month, and she becomes a professor today. The governing board of the Tata Institute of Social Sciences and my chairman, governing board chairman, Mr. S. Ramadurai, they are extremely pleased to invite Dr. Vandana Gopikumar as professor of social work. It's a permanent Government of India job. The seventh pay commission is already working. So basically, that's aside. But the point here is that the governing board of the Tata Institute of Social Sciences invites Dr. Vandana Gopikumar to be the professor of social work. And we will be requesting Professor Vandana Gopikumar to be able to consolidate the work that is happening around here in the area of mental health. She will be based in Chennai, not in Mumbai. She will be based in Chennai and provide support to and guide the mental health program, teaching, research, field action, and policy advocacy and publications work, along with my colleagues, you know, we have stalwarts sitting here actually. So along with them, we create a new context for addressing mental health issues in the country. So may I request you, ma'am, to it is a tradition at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences that the newly appointed professors deliver your professorial address. So, Professor, may I request you to deliver the address?
So, good afternoon, everybody. First of all, Dr. Parshuraman and Mr. Mohan Kumar, thank you so much for this honor. It's truly, truly overwhelming. I think the vision that you have is extremely progressive. You have, I think, etched out a plan for the next 10 years in terms of human resource development, which is extremely critical to the mental health sector. The Banyan, Balm, on behalf of Dr. Kishore, Dr. Vikram Gupta, Miriam, and my senior colleagues, I'm very happy, and our dean and my teacher from Grass School, Dr. Nalini Rao, I'm extremely happy to pledge our commitment to this vision. So this lecture, I'm hoping, while it doesn't follow too clear a structure, I'm hoping I'll touch upon a few issues based on my own experience and the experience of the Banyan. And hopefully using these anecdotes, communicate to you the importance of social work in the country, social work practice in the country, but also with specific relevance to mental health and marginality. So let me begin with, like conversations with God, let me begin with conversations with Bob. Bob Rosenheck from Yale, whom I met about 2 or 3 days ago, and me and my colleagues were having a conversation with him. And he was talking about the models in America that reached out to homeless people, and he mentioned being engaged with them and researching them, and then he turned and looked at us and said, so Vandana, have you studied these models and evaluated their impact? And then he turned around and said that maybe, just maybe, that you won't be too happy with the results that you see. And then I said, yes, well, we have. In fact, Dr. Kishore, who's now our director, when he was with NIMHANS, had reviewed the work of the Banyan. And what they did, the team at NIMHANS, that's Dr. Srinivasamurthy and Dr. Kishore, is that they looked at the women who we had reached out to, provided services to, and who'd returned back home to different parts of the country. I'm not going into the details of that. And at that point, we realized that 40% of them continued to stay well. But with 60% of them, some of them had passed on, some of them had committed suicide, some of them were no longer at home, some of them had returned to the streets. So we were aware of that pattern. And now, where are we 13 years later? These are some of the statistics, 1740 people that we have reached out to. 1,100 we have reintegrated. These are approximate statistics. Vikram and Preeta have the exact statistics. And now, again, if you add 300, 150, 200, 200, it's still about 40 to 45% of people who continue to stay in touch, continue to remain in active contact and service, and who seem to be doing well. So we're still, you know, working around that number. So what does that mean? Should we give up? Did we give up? Now, this was 2001, and this is 13 years later. It's 23 years in Kenya. We didn't give up. On the contrary, what we did, while this is a very important point, it's important to realize that it's only 40% or 45% that we're reaching out to, but those lives are saved. Those lives are productive. But we're not happy just stopping at that. I think what we did post that is proven to the reasons. Why are the rest of them not well? Why are they sliding back into homelessness or ill health or poverty or distress? And then these are the reasons that are thrown up time and over. The lack of access to care, so we have the district mental health program. I'm not going to go into those details because I think I've bored you enough with those, but we still have not 123, but Dr. Kishore tells me it's 189 out of 640, but highly embedded in a pill-popping culture, and there's very little counseling, there's very little social care, there's very little support of other forms. So access pathway is clearly an issue. Poverty, I mean, all of us, we don't have to talk about it. We still know about the 37% who live below the poverty line. And though that seems a statistic, but it's very significant numbers. And related family, I don't use the word burden now because many people, many friends of mine who are caregivers do not like referring to the people that they love. And as you know, the word burden doesn't really suit their process of caregiving. So it's really the losses, whether it's loss of wages or whether it's loss of loss of productivity, or whether it's loss of finances, or if it's sheer anguish at seeing another person suffer, and particularly being concerned with the cause of what after me, what when I'm no longer there to take care of this person. So there are a lot of losses that the individual and the family encounter, and also very important point, the complex interactions that take place between poverty, mental ill health, homelessness, and the many other social stresses. So we're not ready to give up as yet, because there are many reasons which we have listed, which we need to probe into, I think, in greater detail. So in this relation, this context, who is a social work practitioner? Now, this is something that you have obviously studied over the past year or so. Our main goal really is to focus on equity and justice promotion, which is why saving lives, even if it sounds rather fluffy, is the most important thing that we do. Reaching out to people, empowering them, ensuring that they can walk the path of independence. These are the things that we feel extremely passionate and extremely committed to. So working with marginalized groups obviously becomes a very important point there, such as the homeless people, engaging with extremely complex problems, such as that of mental ill health or homelessness or poverty or the intersections. Reconciling, and this is again very crucial, because otherwise there is a strong chance that you end up being burnt out, reconciling with a lack of clarity of outcomes. There is a strong chance that you engage, and I go back to Bob's question, that you engage and you know that there aren't great results, and of course you're not happy, and of course you're distressed, and of course you want to probe deeper and find results and find ways and have a clear, sure shot method of reaching out to people and making a difference. But you also know that this is the nature and cause of mental ill health, and while it is imminently treatable, early identification helps, but there are chances with severe mental disorders that you continue to live with disability. It's better to reconcile to that rather than to fool yourself in believing that you're going to expect miracles and end up with a burnout. So I think it's very critical for the social work practitioner to be aware of the reality and reconcile the fact that there could be lack of clarity in outcomes. And because you work in marginalized groups and complex problems, you obviously have to be integrative in your practice. It has to be collaborative in nature. You also very clearly operate at different levels. You work with the individual, you work with families and communities, and you also work at the policy level. Besides this, what really draws me to social work is two critical things. That one, we focus on problem solving. It's not always the problem, but the fact that we need to solve the problem, come up with solutions, innovate, stimulate action, and that really is very exciting. And when we do that, we focus on the strengths approach and on solutions-based therapy. And sometime back, I was speaking to Nachiketa and telling him about intuition and how it is critical. And of course, typically you have designs and you follow them and you standardize them, and that you remove error from your operations by doing that. But I think in social work practice, intuition, following your gut feel, these become extremely critical. Reflective practice, and I'll talk about that just in a bit, is a very, very important part of the problem-solving process and thus of social work practice. When you focus on values, very clearly, the user is always at the center. So if there is a need, then you respond. And you respond to a certain extent, and then again reinvent yourself to suit the needs of the user. You don't drive the program, the user drives the program. And thus, you are obviously responsible. And because you're responsible, you have to be accountable. And you do all this with a sense of empathy and deep engagement. And if you're all this, it just so ends up that you are persistent and persuasive and continue to engage with a complex problem. But this is really pretty much the order, because the more you engage with the problem, the more you're able to embed yourself in it, the more you're able to immerse yourself, the more intuitive you become. And the more intuitive you become, the more responsive you are. The more responsive you are, the more persistent you are. So you chase solutions. So there is a process to it, and there is a theory to it. We won't get into that today. That's for later classes. So while I'm not getting to too many of the theories, there are some theories that guide social work practice. And there are three critical theories that I'd like to talk about briefly. One is the ecological systems theory, and I find this very important, not just for the people that we serve, but also in respect to me or you, the practitioner. The person is always in the environment. The person in the environment, you can't look at the person independent of the environment. So how you behave depends on your environment, and vice versa. How I behave also depends on my environment. So I think this becomes a very critical focus point, which means the focus is always, it's dual focus. It's on the client and on the environment. Similarly, in your social learning theory, which is both, again, relevant to the student or to the social work practitioner and to the client. This, again, reinforces the belief of the ecological systems theory, but considers the influence of values, beliefs, reasoning, self-determination, emotions, and thought on the learning process. So a lot of what we do is determined by our early years, by our childhood, by our adolescence, by what we've been exposed to, by what our belief systems are. And remember again that this is not just true of the client, but this is also very much true of all of us. And we have to be aware of it when we practice. So we're able to set aside our bias if we have to. And finally, the systems theory, which says that all human behavior can be explained in the form of complex systems, which means there could be a particular problem, which is an individual's problem, but the solution is often a collective solution. So it's the community, the family, and many other people. It's very true of the Indian context in particular. Many of us respond to it. So a problem, especially mental ill health, is never the problem of just the individual, okay? So now we've spoken about the theories, but very quickly, what are the tools? I mentioned that action learning is a very critical tool. So essentially, social work practitioners are problem solvers. They look at problems, complex problems, and they try and solve it. And how do they solve it? They solve it by learning while in practice. And this becomes extremely critical, but it is also a very tough thing to do. So typically in social work practice, according to this tool, you learn in sets. So you have a group of people, and while you learn in practice, you discuss what you learn with the others in the team, and sometimes this activity is supervised. It's a very private activity. It's also a very comforting activity, so there has to be a sense of trust amongst people. And this again becomes very critical in social work practice, particularly in the case of mental health. Obviously, if you are looking at action learning, you also have to look at reflective practice. But reflective practice, according to academics and those in practice, works only when it results in a certain amount of action. So there's no point just reflecting and staying at that. That's fine, that's good. But go a step beyond and use the knowledge derived from that reflection as a result of action learning into another set of knowledge which you can then apply in practice. And of course, critical thinking. All of us know about critical thinking, so I'm not going into detail. So now we've done social work practice. How do you place that in the context of mental health and marginality in India? Now, there are three or four theoretical frameworks that I really like in the context of mental health. Again, I'm not going to look into this in detail, but basically, you see the bi-directional impact, right? So reduced development resulting in mental health conditions. Mental health conditions resulting in poverty. Poverty resulting in mental health conditions. Mental health conditions resulting in increased vulnerability, stigma, violence, lack of educational opportunities, worse in mental health. So it's bi-directional, which means no longer is all this discussion sitting in the dopamine or in the serotonin phases. It's moved beyond, right? So I like this as well very much, so social capital, and you see the networks resulting finally in common mental disorders. Again, over here. I will share this presentation with you, so I'm not going into it in detail because we don't have too much of time, but it's very interesting to look at both the individual pathways and the community pathways, and how lack of social support networks in both cases could result in poverty or here chronic stress, resulting in mental disorders. And you would think that this is limited to common mental disorders, but that is not the case. Even in the case of schizophrenia, as Richard Warner has indicated, look at the different levels, right? And again, you look at parental bonding, look at maladaptive learning, family communication, look at stressful life events, and you look at all of this. So there is a critical role that social work practitioners have to play, even if you look at just mental health and leave aside the poverty, leave the homelessness, leave all of that aside, but even just in this, even if you were to relate this to your critical learning or reflective practice or action learning or the person and environment, obviously it makes a lot of sense because the two clearly come together. So in India, what worsens the situation? Clearly the WHO has stated that 3/4 of the global burden of neuropsychiatric disorders is borne by the Lamis. Now, like I was speaking to Vikram earlier today, this it's not etched in gold, but this is a statistic. And it is also visible that there are many more people who are unwell here, whether it's a mental illness or whether it's distress, one doesn't know, but we'll get to that later. According to the 2010 World Disability Report, the poorest worldwide are those with psychosocial disabilities, which is really a very sad reflection of our society and our society and government's commitment to this group of very, very vulnerable people. And we know that the reality in India is not great today. Though I read in the Hindu 2 days ago that the number of people who have risen out of poverty and moved up to the middle socioeconomic bracket has increased. So that is an interesting trend. But we also have to understand that it's multidimensional, the poverty and marginality. So there's discrimination on the basis of many, many, many aspects. It could be health access, or it could be on the basis of caste and class, or gender, or lack of primary education. If you look at it, I mean, it's cyclic. So depending on where you're born, if I'm born in a poor family, and this has nothing to do with my ability, nothing, I'm just born in a poor family, straight away, there is a chance that I am not able to receive the sort of parenting that I may in a privileged family. I may not receive the sort of nutrition that I may in a privileged family. As a result, I may not grow as healthy. If unhealthy, I may not be able to access the sort of facilities that a privileged person may be able to. As a result of all of this, I may not do as well in school as a more privileged person. Worse still, if I'm female, I may have to drop out of school because I'm menstruating and there aren't enough toilets. And there's a clear correlation between this that has been discussed in a report. Otherwise, statistics. But these are real people that we're talking about. So, for the case of Najma and Hasina, for example, where Najma was rescued by us outside a city college when she was just 5. Her mother Hasina was, she was assaulted by the police. And her hand still remains sort of bent because of the injury. So she lives with those fears, and I don't think those fears will ever go away. And this is what the child experienced. And obviously the mother having to care for the child and not being well and not being able to access support and not being able to communicate could have been a very, very distressing situation. And she says, thank God I was young, I don't remember the meanness. Or Selvi, for that matter, who again was found on the beach and attempting to sell her child because she was hungry to the police. Unfortunately, the police saw that happen and tried to reach out. And here it was the mother who was unwell with a little baby. Or, for that matter, because mental illness doesn't discriminate, it's not just the poor who are affected, an IIT graduate who lost her parents and her siblings were out of the country. And so she ended up unwell and she was roaming the streets till she was brought to us. So these are real stories, and thanks to some of the interventions using the tools that I had mentioned earlier, whether it's action learning or the values that I had spoken about earlier, Sheila today went back to the same school and she's completed her bachelor's and her master's in history, and she actually, I introduced her to Mr. Desi Raju, and she's now an IAS aspirant, and hopefully she is responsible and driven. I don't know, her mother isn't too well, but she's very happy with her daughter's progress, and she lives in one of the shared housing options of the Banyan. Or Selvi, who we figured later belonged to Gudalur, which is a small tribal belt in the Nilgiris, and it was because of lack of access to care that she ended up homeless. So if only care were available locally, she perhaps would have just managed with the resources there, continued to stay with her family. But now she accessed the Banyan's acute care service and then transitioned several services till she got to a point where she said, look, I'm well now, I need to go back home. Before she went home, she actually federated a self-help group, led it, ran an enterprise, and then decided to return, and she does well now, has been awarded a BAM fellowship and works as a peer counselor. Son is being educated as well. But just as there are good stories, there are bad stories, and we have to reconcile to live with those bad stories. So Pooja, the IIT graduate, she was averse to medication, and she actually has been one of our best teachers, because the first night that she came to the Banyan seems to have been a horrible night, where I think the reception wasn't very warm. She seems to have been alone, and she saw a lot of people, and she belongs to a different background, and then suddenly seeing all these people, the next morning there wasn't too much of privacy, I think, in the bathing process. She was insecure and she never reconciled. So she spent a large part of her life going to the court and filing PILs or complaining about the Banyan, coming back to the Banyan in the evening. She knew we were friends,
but she didn't reconcile to what had happened to her those first that first night. So I think she remains, and people like her remain teachers. And when she died, she of course continued to live with delusions, and she thought her parents were in the temples. So she would visit the temple, come to the banyan, but when she was really ill, she decided that she would just come back and die at the banyan. So typically, the banyan has followed action learning. You see that. So we plan, we act, this is the plan, we observe what happens, and then we reflect, and then that feeds back into the plan. So this process depicts the many, many phases of the banyan, resulting in what Dr. Parshuraman has already explained, this phase of the banyan, where we believe that there is a need to move from practice to academics and to building human resource capability. So finally, to conclude, I have to say that I, as a social work practitioner, in the past 23 years, I have enjoyed myself, because as a result of the practices that I've followed, I've been able to, within myself and in the organization that I lead, stimulate creativity and innovations. And I think that becomes very critical when you deal with complex problems. And what are the innovations? Our transit care facility. We have spoken much in Vikram Masrana trial on the non-specialist workforce. But 23 years ago, we started off with the non-technical workforce in our very first setting, where we respond to the needs of homeless people, which we knew at that point intuitively would ensure cost-effective care of a modest quality. Similarly, we run an open shelter, but in that open shelter, again, Harsh, I know, mentioned that there's a lot of stigma that such shelters face, but we've managed to sort of mitigate that by stimulating balanced interactions in the community. So the community, even children from the community, come in to a shelter that where nothing was happening earlier. People just wouldn't go there. There was a Balwadi that didn't even operate as a result of the homeless men living there, but now the Balwadi operates, children come. There's mutually beneficial interactions between the community and the residents. Non-institutional long-term care approaches, this becomes a very, very serious problem, because even in the banyan you see a lot of people now requiring long-term care, and this is going to be the next large problem that our country faces in mental health. So here again we've tried many approaches, with housing and social mobility or promoting social inclusion being very, very critical aspects. And finally, this ecosystem, I think, is another innovation that we are very happy about, where you have teaching on the one hand, you have the clustered groups, homes, on the other, women live here, there's a healthy interaction between the two groups, it's a nice positive energy, and the women run the cafe or the social enterprise, so they're seen as independent, you don't have to communicate. What do you students think? Do you think it's interesting to be a part of this setup?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right, so fine, you can't say no, obviously. So finally, moving forward, what is the strategic direction?
I think a reality check. Reality check is important. There is lack of understanding in society as far as social work goes. Internal quality checks, I don't know if you're very certain about the quality of our education, quality of our practice. So can we showcase models? Can we collaborate in education with practitioners and in research with practitioners and in practice with researchers? Can we play a more significant role in social policy? And can we also play a role in leadership? So three critical thoughts that I leave behind with you. If we can work on these as part of Dr. Parshuraman's vision and the vision of the Banyan and BAM and your department, TIS's department. Now, there is always a debate between the mental hospital and care in the community, and it's always an either or. But have we weighed the pros and cons? What exactly is coercive treatment? How can we look at reforms? If so, of what sort? Can there be some collective action on this? I mean, there are 43 hospitals, and I think they provide a critical service. Obviously, they need reforms, but can we just spell out what exactly the nature of the reforms need to be, and not just decide that it has to be one or the other? The second is standardization versus individualization. I think this is very important for us, because I'm just a little worried that in order to focus on design and protocol, we'll just be a little too quick and get everybody who's distressed or just even merely sad into the treatment system and diagnose it as a common mental disorder. So that is a fear. So where is the thin line? When does distress end, and when does pathology begin? So can we just be very clear about that and understand that? And finally,
what is treatment commitment? I mean, is it that we are being a little too patronizing? Of course it is important, and we are chasing people all the while. We've had huge arguments with Vikram and the Tata Trust, and to what extent do we do it? How much is too much? And is it crushing the ability of a person to be resilient if you're constantly engaging with the person? So these are certain questions that I think we need to focus on, and I think I've exceeded my time hugely, but you all are being kind, so thank you very much. I hope we can together build a better future for our families.